because that's why you are here for, to see equations or not. This is a rock trencher that we use in dry soil. You know, if you are from Holland, you are used to it that if we want to, for example, put all the electricity cables under the ground or the sewer system, we just dig in sand, in clay. We call that soft soil. But if you are in areas where you have mountains, usually the soil is rocky. It's very hard material. And then if you want to dig a trench to put all the cables in, yeah, you can't just do that with normal equipment. You need such a rock trencher. So this is the type of equipment to make trenches in very hard material. And in fact, in rock, the behavior, the cutting forces and the whole process is almost similar above water and underwater, if the water is not too deep, which we will see later. So this is a typical rock trencher. You saw in the disaster in New York with that storm Sandy, I think it was called, you saw that they had a lot of problems with the electricity, because in the US most of the electricity cables are still above ground. You see those poles with the cables in between, and if you have such a storm, you also have a problem with the electricity. So a couple of million people didn't have electricity anymore. In Europe, usually we put it under the ground and it's just a matter of money. Yeah, if you put it under the ground, it's more expensive in the beginning, but you have less maintenance later. In oil drilling, we also cut rock, and in fact in oil drilling we cut the hardest types of rock, because if you are searching for oil, yeah, you have to go through any material you encounter. It doesn't matter how hard it is. Well, this is a series of drill bits they may use for drilling oil and gas. And you can see here black round plates. Those black round plates we call PVC bits or Stratopax bits, and they are made of artificial diamond, because diamond is the hardest material, and if you want to cut through the hardest rock, you need material that's harder, and the only thing that's harder is diamond. So we use diamond bits to cut rock. Here I have some examples of those bits. You can see the steel at the bottom and the black at the surface. You have the artificial diamond, and yeah, so they can cut through any material. A big difference, which we will also see later, is between oil drilling and dredging, is that in oil drilling such a bit has a diameter of about 10 millimeters and you cut a layer of about 0.2 millimeters. So the layer you are cutting is very thin. In fact, you are scraping the material off, and for oil drilling it's not about a huge production. Like in dredging we like cubic meters per second. Well, in oil drilling it's just a little bit, as long as I get through the rock and finally I reach the oil. Yeah. They wear, so every now and then you have to pull back the whole string, the whole drill string, and you have to replace them. So it, but it depends, of course, on the type of rock and the depth, how often you have to do that. But that's one of the reasons. If you see this picture, you can see that such a drill bit consists of the top, which is a little bit bigger than the cylinder behind it. So here this is the back of the drill bit, and this part you connect to the pipe. Now, so the drill bit has a bigger diameter than the cylinder behind it, the whole drill string. And that's because through this pipe you have the fluid very often driving the drill bit, so you can choose between rotating the whole drill string from the platform, but you can imagine if it becomes very long you get a lot of torsion, and what is the guarantee that finally your drill bit will rotate at constant speed? Yeah, that's difficult if you have a few kilometers of pipe. So another way of doing this is behind the drill bit you have a turbine. You pump a fluid, a heavy fluid, through the cylinder, and that heavy fluid is driving the turbine, driving the drill bit, and that way you can control the revolutions much better. And then this fluid will come out of the drill bit and it will flow back through the annulus around the pipe. And that way you remove all the particles that you are cutting. Because if you don't remove those particles, yeah, they will accumulate behind the drill bit, and then if you have to pull back the drill bit, it won't work anymore. So you have to remove all the particles you are cutting to keep it clear. Usually they use, for this fluid, they use a mixture of water and bentonite. Bentonite is artificial clay, and bentonite mixed with water, if you have a very high concentration, you actually get clay. But if you have a low concentration, it behaves like a so-called Bingham fluid. And a Bingham fluid is a fluid with some strength. Yeah, normal fluids like water we call Newtonian fluids, and Newtonian fluids do not have strength. So if I put water on a table, it will flow out. Toothpaste is like a Bingham fluid. If I put toothpaste on the table, it will keep its shape, at least for a while, and it can only keep its shape if it has some internal strength, some shear strength. Yeah, so toothpaste has some shear strength, so it behaves like a Bingham fluid, and bentonite also behaves like a Bingham fluid, so it has some strength of its own. The big advantage of this is that particles that are floating in the Bingham fluid will not really settle because the fluid has strength. Yeah, so it's easier for the fluid to take all the particles out of the drill hole and keep it clean. But if you would have very big particles, they could still settle because, yeah, if the gravity on a particle is larger than the strength of the fluid, it will still settle. But if you have small particles, that's not the case, so they will stay floating. Yeah, so that's about those drill bits. So if you look at the cutting theories that we will discuss later, one of the applications could be drilling for oil. So those were the bits. This is an example of dry mining, and you can see this is, well, in fact, in mining, you could distinguish between two types of mining. Well, first of all, you have wet and dry mining, so above water and underwater, but you also have mining in soft soil, and you have mining in very hard soil. So if you are mining in a mountain, you use this kind of equipment. Usually they have a lot of power, and it's all about rock cutting, stone, rock, whatever. This is another example of a machine they use in tunnel boring, but this is tunnel boring in mountains, in rock. Yeah, so the tunnels in Switzerland and Austria are made partly with machines like this. This is another tunnel boring machine. TBM is an international term for tunnel boring machine, and this is the type of machine we can also use in soft soil. The problem in soft soil, if you want to make a tunnel in Holland, the problem is that you are constantly under the water level. And that means if you are digging and you have no protection, the water will flow into the machine and everything will be damaged. If you make a tunnel in Switzerland, in the mountain, you don't have to deal with that groundwater problem. So this is a tunnel boring machine. In fact, those machines have the diameter of the tunnel, so it makes the tunnel at once. Here you can see two pictures of what it looks like. Usually they are what we call integrated tunnel boring machines, which means at the front here and here they are removing the soil. Then the soil goes into the machine, and it depends on whether it's dry soil or hard soil. If it's dry or wet soil, if it's dry soil, very often they have a conveyor belt system in the machine to remove all the soil. If it's under the water line and in the groundwater, usually the soil they remove is mixed with water, and they have a pipe system and they will pump the material away. It completely depends on where you are. Then behind, behind the boring part, here you can see they place the segments of the tunnel immediately. And then you would say, oh, how can such a tunnel boring machine move forward? Well, they place the segments of the tunnel, so the cylindrical segments. And then you have cylinders, which you can see in this picture. Those cylinders push the front forward. Yeah, so they push over the distance of one segment, remove the soil. Then the cylinders pull back the back part of the tunnel boring machine, and they can place one more segment of the tunnel. And this is the type of machine, for example, they used for the Het Groene Hart in Holland, where they made a tunnel. And I also thought for the Oosterschelde, they are busy with a tunnel. So somewhere the machine goes underground, and then 10 kilometers further it will come up again, and at the end you have a full tunnel. You should think of meters per day. Yeah, it's not very fast. So it between the moment it goes underground and the moment it comes up again, it could be a year. Yeah, it's very slow, because it's not just removing the soil, but it's also placing the segments. And this is a very accurate business, because if you do something wrong, the tunnel will start leaking and you have a lot of problems. So it's a rather complicated process. In fact, for the Channel Tunnel from France to England, they also use such a kind of machine. Well, in fact, they use two, because you have two tunnels. So usually for tunnels for normal traffic, they for each direction you have one machine. So they use two machines, and one machine could do two lanes, something like that. Then I have a picture of the biggest machine in the world. And nowadays not many people hear about this, but when I was a student we often had excursions. You had? Okay. Those are machines for the German brown coal mines, and those mines are close to Maastricht, just across the border. And I think they would have like 20 of those machines in a row. They are really huge, If you stand beside the tracks, you have to look up, and it's like a huge building. And I think they have 7 of those tracks under each machine. Well, what those machines do, you have an area with brown coal. And in fact, brown coal is the first stage of the formation of, you could say, black coal or oil. Oil, gas, coal are created by organic matter, which is under pressure. And if you wait long enough and you have enough sediment on top of it, so you get high pressures, at the end you may have oil or gas. It depends on the organic matter. But one of the first stages, we also had that in Holland, but in Holland we call it veen. Veen is also that organic matter which compacts a little bit. You can burn it, and that's why they used it for power plants and so on. And in Holland we used that veen for heating houses long time ago. Well, in Germany they had areas, and just imagine you have an area of 10 by 10 kilometers. And you know there's a layer of brown coal of, let's say, 20 meters high. But on top of that layer of brown coal, first you have a layer of 10 meters of normal soil. So you have to remove 10 meters of soil, 10 by 10 kilometers, with those machines before you hit the brown coal. So probably they are busy 1 year or 2 years to remove the topsoil, and then they can start producing brown coal. I thought one of those machines in those days, you talk about 300 or 400 million euros, something like that. So if you have 20 of those machines, you can calculate the investment. Then you have to work for a year to remove the topsoil, and then you start digging the brown coal. This is a big, what we call, dredging wheel. So this is cutting the material. Here you have a conveyor belt. Then the material is dumped in the central unit to another conveyor belt over here. And then on land you have a fixed conveyor belt where they put the material on. And then it goes to some railway station where they dump everything on a train to be transported to wherever they need it. They still use them, but of course brown coal is not the cleanest way of getting energy. It's one of the reasons why in the past we had this acid rain, zure regen. It came from the brown coal because, yeah, it's not compacted enough and it doesn't burn too clean. But nowadays, like with coal, in huge power plants they can burn things much cleaner, and they have many installations to clean the gases that come out of the burning process. So now they can do it clean, but only in the huge installations. Then I want to say something about deep sea mining, because in dredging, if you want to do the master's thesis in dredging, one of the topics that is very hot right now is deep sea mining. And what is deep sea mining? Well, first of all, some impressions. Deep sea mining means that we like to get metals, minerals, in fact whatever is valuable, it could also be phosphates, we like to get them from the seafloor. And why? Well, one of the main reasons is that a number of rare materials and metals are mainly found in China. China, of course, wants to protect their own industry. So in the rapid development of China, but also the whole world, they say, okay, we want to use the things we find in China first for our own industry, which makes sense to me. But that means, since a number of those metals are mainly found in China, the rest of the world has a problem. So the rest of the world starts searching, where can we find those metals? And in fact, a number of those metals are used for iPhones, iPads, for those screens. And so nowadays, there's a lot of demand for those metals. So they searched in the world, and they didn't really find those materials on land, but they found it in the sea. Only on locations where the sea could be 3 kilometers depth. 2-3 kilometers. Yeah, okay, so we know it's there, but how to get it? I must say, right now, there are not yet real projects to get the material from the seafloor, but especially in Holland, many companies are busy doing research and making big investments to investigate how can we develop equipment to get those materials from the seafloor. And this just gives some impressions. So here you have a ship at the surface, but in the areas where they have those minerals, often the weather is not so nice that you have a smooth surface, so there could be a storm or whatever. Then on the seafloor you have machines digging the material, because it's not just sediment laying there, it could be rock. Yeah, it could be rock containing 1% gold or something like that. And then it's worth to get it, but you have to dig it with very tough machines, the machines that we use for tunnel boring, and those kind of machines. So that's what you see here. And then you also have to get the material to the surface. So most people think of a pipeline with a pump somewhere down below, pumping the material up. But now there are also ideas to start with a sort of lift, and use a sort of lift on cables to pull the material up. And in fact, together with one of the PhDs, we are going to write a paper to compare economically, but also for the energy, we will compare the difference between pumping it to the surface and doing it with a sort of lift. Yeah? This could be 3 kilometers. Yeah, so the picture shows that it's just 20, 30 meters, but in reality it could be 3 kilometers deep.
And then they use multiple pumps, I guess?
In the idea of IHC for this, they have we call it a riser, the pipeline going up, it's called a riser, and they use 5 pumps. So, and then you also have the problem of how to get the power there. So this is just an artist impression. Well, this is another artist impression with a sailing ship, and the other ship was more a floating ship. This is more a sailing ship. And here you see this is from IHC, because I recognize this device. It's a design of IHC. Well, where can you find those things? In fact, I think most of you know that our planet is not made of rock, but in fact our planet inside is fluid. Yeah, it's magma. It's the stuff that comes out of volcanoes. And on top of that magma we have tectonic plates. Yeah, so the surface of the planet is not one shell like an egg. No, it's plates, and those plates float on the magma. And those plates usually have a certain velocity. Not very high, but there is a velocity. And here you can see different plates, so those lines give the borders of those plates. And wherever the plates touch each other, there is basically three things that can happen. The plates hit each other. Well, in such a case, if two plates hit each other, they push up and you get mountains. So the Himalaya is typically at the border of two big plates. It's also possible that they are removing yeah, so the distance is increasing, because if somewhere two plates are hitting each other, then at the other end two plates have to create more distance. Well, if they create more distance, it means you get very deep water. So for example, near Japan, where is it? Here. Somewhere near Japan, the Mariana Trough in Dutch. It's 11, 12 kilometers deep over there, and that's because they are moving apart. And then the third way you can have an interaction is shearing. Yeah, they move like this. And basically that's what's happening here at the west coast of the USA. If you ever have the opportunity to fly to LA or San Diego, take a flight from Amsterdam by KLM. They will fly over the North Pole. Yeah, normally everybody would say this is the shortest distance, but it's not, because the Earth is a sphere. You fly over the North Pole and then you arrive like this, vertically, and then from the plane you can actually see this shearing. You can see roads that used to be one road, and now one road is here and the other part is here, because this it's sheared like this. You can actually see that. And it's but you can only see it from a plane. If you walk there, you don't see a thing. But that's the reason why you often have earthquakes in the west coast of the USA. And you also have like Mount St. Helens in the north of the USA, which had a huge explosion 20, 30 years ago. And the whole top of the mountain was removed by the volcanic eruption. And well, that's because you have this shearing. Yeah, because of the shearing, sometimes the pressure of the magma becomes so big it can come to the surface, and then you have a volcano. And that's the way it works. Luckily, those processes are very slow. So on the time scale of a human life, we don't really have too much trouble of this. But if you look on a different time scale, there's a lot of activity. So here you can see all the places where those plates hit each other or shear or whatever. Well, in many of those locations, because of the volcanic activity, there will be certain metals, minerals at the seafloor. And one of the ways it works, and this is what we are looking at specifically, at that 3 kilometer water depth, you have the heat at the bottom, you have heat coming from the magma, from the center of the earth. On the other hand, there is water moving into the pores of the rock, of the stone, because also rock has a certain permeability, so water can flow in rock, but usually not as much as in sand. The permeability is much lower, but it doesn't mean there is no water flowing. It's the same as if you look at an electricity wire. Everybody say the plastic around it is completely isolating for electricity. That's not true. If you have a sensitive measurement device, you can still measure the current coming out of the wire. But the current is so small that it's not dangerous for people, and we say, okay, so it's safe. But it doesn't mean there is no flow of electricity out of the wire. It's still there. There's also a magnetic field around the wire. Yeah? So it doesn't isolate 100%. It just isolates enough. Well, in the same way, rock, stone has a very low permeability, but it doesn't mean there's no water flowing. So water is still flowing into the seafloor, gets heated by the heat from the magma below, and it actually starts cooking. The temperature of that water could go up. Well, I know over here the temperature could go up to 400 degrees. But because you are under such a high pressure, it doesn't yet start cooking, but it's already 400. But then you can imagine in the stone, yeah, maybe it's 1000. Yeah, it could be very hot. Well, what happens? So the water gets heated, the water absorbs metals, minerals, whatever. Yeah, it goes into the water, and then yeah, the water has to find a way out, because first of all the volume of water is increasing with temperature. Yeah, the lowest volume you have at about 4 degrees, but at 1000 the volume is much bigger, so there's a lot of pressure, so the water has to get out of the stone, and that's what's happening here. And then the water mixed with those metals comes out of a sort of mini volcano. It's not a real volcano, it's just because of the water, and because of all the metals and so on in the water, it looks black. So that's why we call it a black smoker. Then it cools, and all the particles in the water will settle, and that's how this volcano is formed. So the longer you wait, the bigger the volcano. Well, all the material that settles on the seafloor and around the black smoker usually contains a lot of metals and minerals. They have found cases there where the soil contained 30% copper, which is really a lot. And if you make an economic calculation, well, you can calculate that if you get like 100 cubic meters a day to the to the surface, it could already be profitable because of the price of the copper. And you can imagine if you would have 1% gold, well, in 1 cubic meter, that means 1 liter of gold, which I think is 14 kilos or so. Well, 1 kilo on the free market is 44,000 euros. So that could be profitable. Yeah, so maybe the amount you need is not that much because of the price, but how to get it. Here you can see some pictures of what it really looks like, and you should keep those pictures in mind, because you can see the seafloor is not a nice flat seafloor. By the way, those chimneys could be up to 20 meters high. I don't know how high this one is, but this could be 20 meters, so it's not just something on the seafloor, it's really big. And that also means, yeah, you can't just put some vehicle on tracks on the seafloor and start digging, because, yeah, the seafloor is not flat. It's a lot of mountains and hills and rocks and whatever. This is another picture of such a black smoker, so this is what they actually look like. Here you can see a picture of what the seafloor looks like, and then you can see it's not flat. Yeah. So if you want to use vehicles on tracks, first you have to make it flat yourself, and then you could, from there, you could start getting all the material from the seafloor. This is some idea of what a platform could look like, and in fact it's a copy of what we use in the oil and gas business. It's a semi-submersible. You can see the riser here coming from the seafloor, and then regularly all the material, maybe it's already pre-processed on the semi-sub, it has to be transported to a shuttle tanker, which is this one, to bring it to shore. This is an impression of IHC. IHC, Dutch shipyard, they are very busy with this. They already started a special department for deep sea mining, and they have many ideas on how you could deal with it. This is a close-up of that picture. So, this in fact is a drum cutter to remove the material, but yeah, we still have to do a lot of research, because the design of such a vehicle depends on what do we actually find. Here you can see a machine also on tracks. Here you see the drum cutter, and here you can see the connection to the riser. So inside the vehicle, the material that you are cutting is mixed with water, and then it has to go into the pumping system. And probably there's already a first pump in the vehicle, but that pump will never be strong enough to pump it all the way to the surface. Another impression, here they have two vertical rotating cutters. And why do they do that? If you make the two cutters counter-rotating, you don't get a side force on your vehicle. If you only have one cutter, well, not with a drum cutter like this, you also don't have a side force, but if you would have a cutter like this, you always get a side force. Yeah, and is the connection between the tracks and the seafloor strong enough to keep it in the right direction? But if you do two counteracting ones, you remove the side force. Not 100%, because the cutting forces on both cutters will never be exactly the same, but you can remove most of the side force. This is a device they already use in reality, but not for those water depths. Yeah? Yeah, according to me, one of the designers of IHC read too many comic books. Right, exactly. It's an artist impression. This is a clamshell I already showed before, because one of the ideas is you can use cutters to cut the material, and that means you already create very small particles at the seafloor and then pump it. But if with a clamshell you could get big chunks of material and transport it to the surface as a big chunk of material, maybe that's cheaper, maybe that's more profitable. And one of the problems we will see later is that under 300 bars, those 300 bars create very high cutting forces. If I would crush the same material at the under atmospheric pressure, probably the energy required to crush it is much less. So it could be profitable to do that at the surface, but we still don't know. So that's part of the research we are busy with. Okay, yeah, it's 5 minutes before, but let's do a break now and then I start the next presentation after the break. Yeah? Any more questions? Explosives. Who is going to put them there? Yeah, but you know, one of the things right now, everybody thinks 3 kilometers, there's no life there. But they are already investigating the whole environment, the biology at those water depths, and it appears there's a lot of life. So nowadays, well, everybody can see that in the newspapers, if you want to do something, you have to take care of the environment. And then using explosives will be a big problem, but also using those machines cutting, I know from the Japanese they already do a lot of research into the environment at those water depths, and that means the United Nations will probably create new regulations, and you have to follow those regulations. So using dynamite, we do it in dredging, but first of all, divers cannot go to those water depths. Submarines, normal submarines, have a maximum water depth of about 300 meters. Yeah, so with a normal submarine, you can't go to 3 kilometers. Who's going to put it there? Because you have to drill. It only works if you drill holes and put the dynamite in the hole. It's not a matter of just placing it at the surface and it the production will not be high enough. And then I think another problem is that part of the working principle of dynamite, of explosives, is the pressure it creates, and especially the pressure difference with atmospheric pressure. Yeah? But there you already have 300 bars. So you should ask the question, will dynamite work at all under 300 bars? I have no idea. Yeah? Okay, we have a break. Okay, a little bit about soil mechanics. If you really want to know a lot about soil mechanics, you should follow a soil mechanics course. But I just want to rehearse some of the basics for those who don't know about it. First, soil creation. If we look at soil, rock, sand, clay, basically in dredging and offshore we distinguish between sand, clay and rock, but there are also many mixed grounds. Well, often soil is created in the mountains, and the mountains are created by those tectonic movements, and what you get in the mountains is you have rock, in the rocks you have cracks, and because it's always very cold in the mountains, there will be water in those cracks, the water will freeze, ice is expanding, and when the ice is expanding, the cracks will grow, and at a certain moment, pieces of rock will fall down the mountain, and usually those are not only the big pieces of rock, but also smaller pieces, and it will arrive at the bottom of the mountain. High in the mountains you have glaciers, so if the pieces of rock fall in the glaciers, they are transported through the glacier. Usually because of friction they will already disintegrate a little bit, and at the bottom of those glaciers you always see a lot of pieces of rock, sand, whatever. At the end of the glacier the ice is also melting, so you get first a small river, and it will become bigger and bigger, and those rivers transport the material all the way to the sea. So you can imagine, if you start at the glacier, you have very angular material because it's just broken from a piece of rock or the mountain, and so it's very angular. Yeah, it's not a nice round particle, it's angular. Then during the transportation through the river, all those particles are transported, especially if you have high flow velocities, but they also hit each other, so there will be some more disintegration, particles get smaller, and the closer you get to the sea, the more round are the particles, and also the more fine material you have. So at the end of the river, usually in an estuary, like in Holland, Holland is one big estuary, the fines will start to settle because the flow velocity is decreasing, and the river gets wider, flow velocity is lower, particles start to settle, so you have a lot of fines in the bottom of the river, and the rest of the material will flow to the sea. So usually if you look on Google Earth and you look at the end of a river, usually in the sea you can see there is a lot of sand which settled over there. So the further you are in this transportation process, the more round the particles. Yeah. Then what can happen through millions of years, you have those tectonic movements, so it could move up, it could move down, there will be more material on top, there could be calcium involved, and if you have calcium in the sand or in the particles, you may get calcium bridges, and then you get something we call sandstone. So it becomes a sort of stone-like material, sedimentary rock, possibly. Many things could happen. Well, for sand, clay, and silt, and one thing, and I will show in another picture after this. In our way of talking, you have sand, which is made of quartz. And if it becomes very fine, we call it silt. But in many classification systems, they say, oh, if I'm below a certain particle diameter, we call it clay. And basically, you should not do that, because clay is a completely different mineral chemically than sand. So if you have quartz powder, you may call it silt, but once it's you talk about a different mineral like bentonite, that's clay. And clay has a completely different behavior than sand. But people mix it up, because if you have silt of, let's say, 2-3 microns, very fine particles, you get the so-called van der Waals forces that take care of some attraction between the particles, and it may look in the behavior a little bit like clay, but it's not. Yeah, clay has chemical behavior, silt has no chemical behavior, because basically quartz is chemically inert. Yeah, for us. Well, they make some classification diagrams. This is just an example, so you don't have to learn this by heart, but it's just an example where you say we have clay, silt, and sand, and then depending on the composition in percentage, they call it sandy loam or clay sand or whatever. Usually in what we are doing in dredging, we are either working with sand, or we work with clay, or we work with rock, and we don't have to deal too much with those mixing soils. Yeah, it could be that you have some clay in your sand, but usually we talk about sand or clay. This is an example of how people classify materials, and you can see for the very fine particles they say we call it clay, and then here you get the silt, and then from fine sand to very coarse sand, and if you go further down you would call it gravel and boulders and so on and so on. But that's what I wanted to say. Clay is chemically different from sand, so in fact it shouldn't be in such a list, but in most books you will find such a classification. For rock, I put this in the lecture notes on Blackboard. You also don't have to learn, but this just gives an overview of the many types of rock that could exist. One of the big problems of rock for us is that many people think rock is very homogeneous. It's massive. But in reality, in rock, you already have a lot of fractures. And the amount of fractures determine how easy it is to cut the rock. So if you have really very homogeneous rock, it's very hard to cut. If it already has a lot of fractures, it's much easier to cut. But how do you know it? So you need testing to determine how strong is the rock really. I will show you some tests later. Then particle size distribution. In any type of soil, you do not have a material where all the particles have the same diameter. So you have a certain distribution. And this is a typical graph of a particle size distribution. In Holland, usually we start here with the smallest diameter. This is in millimeters, and here you see the biggest one. But in American magazines or journals, I often see it reversed. They start here with the biggest diameter and they end with the smallest diameter. But it's easy to see because you always have such an S curve, and if the S curve is opposite, it means you have the opposite scaling. How does it work? Well, this is a so-called cumulative grain distribution curve. That means, for example, if I go here to 50% and I look at the diameter, in this case it would be something like 0.15 millimeter, that means that by weight, 50% of the particles is smaller than 0.15 millimeter. Yeah? If I take 10% here, and for example the red curve, well, I'm at something like 0.022 millimeter, which means 10% of the particles is smaller than that diameter. That's the way this works. In practice, we usually work with what we call the D50. So the D50 is the diameter matching the 50%. Yeah, so here it would be the 0.15, here it's much smaller. But only the D50 doesn't tell you everything, because the steepness of this curve is also important. Yeah, if you only know the D50, you don't know nothing about the steepness of the curve. So, for example, if I have a very steep curve, an almost vertical curve, that would mean all the particles have about the same size. Well, if all the particles have the same size, just do an experiment for yourself with marbles, knikkers. So they are spheres. If I put spheres in a box, I get quite a high porosity, because there are no particles that fit in the pores between those marbles. Yeah, so I get quite a high porosity. But if I have a very low steepness of my curve, it means I have very small particles and I have very big particles. So there will always be smaller particles fitting in the pores between the bigger particles. That means I can have a much higher density, yeah, because all those pores can be filled up with smaller particles. It also means I will probably have a much lower permeability. Permeability is how easy the water will flow through the material. And yeah, if I have big pores, water will flow easy. So if you take gravel, yeah, water hardly has any resistance flowing through the gravel. It has resistance, but relatively small. If I would have sand with a very low steepness and a very small particles, then probably the permeability will be very low. It's very hard for the water to flow. So the steepness of the curve determines on one hand the density. Yeah, so if it's steeper, it's less dense. The sand as a whole, not the density of quartz, but the density of the sand per cubic meter. So with a less steep curve, the density will increase, the permeability will decrease. Another parameter which we will see later is the angle of internal friction. So how much friction do we have? Yeah, if I have particles in the pores between the bigger particles, I will probably also have a higher angle of internal friction. Yeah, so, well, some people use the D15 and the D85 for this, others use the D10 and the D90. So if I know here the D10, this point, and I know the D90, in fact, I can put a straight line between them and I have a measure for my steepness. Whether I do it with the 10 and the 90 or the 15 and the 85, that's a matter of choice. Yeah? Yeah? Yeah. Both, because the particle density for quartz is 2.65, so 2650 kilogram per cubic meter. For normal sand, we always use 2000, so 2.0 in tons per cubic meter. but in fact sand, yeah, sand, that's if you have 40% porosity, but sand could have a porosity, let's say, between 30% and 50%, so you can calculate what the range of the density is. So densities could start at something like 1800, 1900, go up to 2100 for situ sand. But it completely depends on whether it's already compacted, then it will be a little bit more than 2000. If you just let it settle freely, probably you are at 1900 or something. Yeah, and when it's solid depends on the grain distribution, because in dredging now we dredge in the pipeline up to 1800, not often, but 1700 is already rather common. We could go up to 1800, but of course only if it's still fluid, otherwise you can't pump it. So I could make a sand with a density of 1800, which is a solid sand, but I can also make one which is a fluid sand. And if you say which one is the most important, well, if we talk about cutting processes and so on, we deal with the density of the sand in situ, so that's the 2000. If we talk about hydraulic transport and sedimentation in hoppers, you have to deal with the settling velocity of particles, and then it's the density of the quartz that's important. Yeah. So it depends on which application. You know, the problem of dredging is that we are constant at the interface of solid mechanics and fluid mechanics. Yeah, we start with sand and clay as a solid, but as soon as we cut it and it goes into the pipeline system, it's a fluid. And the problem is the people of fluid mechanics, sometimes they do what we call two-phase flow, water and solids or water and gas, but very low concentrations. They never work with the concentrations we work with. We can work up, like I said, 1.8 when you have 50% volumetric solids concentration. Usually they don't work with that. Also, if you go to hydraulic engineering here in this building and you talk about erosion processes in rivers, usually the concentrations are much lower. Yeah, it could be 5%, 10%, but maybe in the Yellow River in China the concentration is a bit higher. They really have a high concentration of solids, but not like what we do. So, and I will also explain the difference, well, maybe I already did, but the main difference with solid soil mechanics and what we do. In soil mechanics, in general, they want to construct something from soil that stays there for a very long time. Building a dike, building a road, building a railroad. And what we do, we want to destroy it in a fraction of a second, because we want to cut it and transport it. And after this I will show you active and passive soil failure, and then you can see the difference between the two. But anyway, this was the particle size distribution. If you take the derivative of this, you could model it as a normal distribution. Not 100%, but it could get close to a normal distribution. And what I do myself is I take the bottom part below the 50% and use that as one normal distribution, and the top part as another normal distribution, both having 50% of the probability. And then if you combine two normal distributions and then integrate them, you can get a good curve for almost any type of soil. Some parameters, Atterberg limits. I must say I don't know too much about them because we don't really use it, but in soil mechanics they often use it. What are they? Well, you have the, maybe there are more limits, but the plastic limit and the liquid limit. Basically with the liquid limit, what you do is you take some clay, those are parameters for clay, you take some clay, you add water until it starts closing because it gets so fluid it starts closing, and then you determine the water content, and that's your liquid limit. The plastic limit is often that you take a piece of clay, you start rolling until you see cracks in the clay, and that's what you call the plastic limit. Well, they have equipment for that, but we cannot really relate those limits to parameters like tensile strength, shear strength, and for the cutting process we need the compressive strength, the shear strength, the tensile strength. Maybe there are empirical equations relating the two, but if I can measure the compressive strength directly, and there's a good device for that, why would I start correlating with those things? So I just mentioned them because in soil mechanics they use them, but we don't really use them. Mass-volume relations, those are important. For example, you have density. Well, density is very simple. Density is the mass divided by the volume, and then you get a density. But soil consists of solids, water, and maybe air. If you are above the water level, probably you also have air in the soil. So you should also know what is the porosity. So porosity is the percentage of pores. Void ratio is the percentage of pores divided by the percentage of solids. So it's a different number, but the meaning is the same. But we always use the porosity. Well, density, as I said, specific gravity is the density of a material divided by, for example, the water density. In fact, in general, we say the fluid density because it doesn't always have to be water. But if you divide it by the water density for normal applications, so the specific gravity of sand is 2.65. Sand is 2650, water is about 1.0, so you get 2.65. If you want to be very accurate, it depends on is it sweet water, salt water. Sweet water is a little bit more than 1.0, and salt water is usually 1.03. Okay, then I should divide the 2650 by 1030, and I'm a little bit more accurate. But for normal calculations, we just say 2.65. Relative density is where are you? If you consider a sand can have a minimum porosity and a maximum porosity, at the minimum porosity we say the relative density is 100% because then it's the most heavy. At the maximum porosity we say the relative density is 0%. So you get a scale from 0 to 100%. But because the 0%, the porosity of 0%, and the porosity of 100% depends on the type of sand, so it gives you some relative feeling, where am I? But you can't say 0% is always a porosity of 50%. Yeah, it depends on the type of sand. But they did research on that, so here you see the scale of 0 to 100% for the relative density. Vertically, the so-called SPT value, which I will explain later in detail, but it basically it's you take a cylinder, you hit it with a certain weight, and you count the number of hits to get 1 foot into the ground. That's the SPT value. And then you can see, well, if my relative density is 0%, so that means the highest porosity, so I have very loose sand, so the SPT value is almost zero, and at 100% it's pretty high. Then permeability. Permeability is how easy can the water flow through the material. And in normal sense, by the way, here it's in centimeters per second, and here you can see different types of material. Well, in normal sense, we have a permeability of about 10 minus 4. Let's say between 10 minus 3 and 10 minus 5. That would be a normal permeability for sand. But as we will see later, the cutting forces are, in certain cases, are proportional with the permeability. So if I have a range of 10 minus 3 to 10 minus 5, that's a factor 100. If I don't know the correct permeability, I could make a mistake of maximum a factor 100 in my cutting forces. And if I'm designing a dredge and I calculate the design loads with a factor 100 in the wrong direction, I have a problem later. Not if it's 100 times too much, it will always work, but it will be too expensive, right? So that's permeability. If you look at clay, the permeability in clay, yeah, it depends on the type of clay, but it could be like 10 to the minus 10, 10 to the minus 11. So compared with sand, there is a factor of about 10 to the sixth lower, which means it's 1 million times less permeable than sand. Yeah, and in rock, it really depends on the type of rock. If it's rather homogeneous rock, the permeability may even be smaller than in clay. But if you have rock with a lot of fractures, yeah. So you can't give a general answer, although in those tables they give some numbers for different types of rock. Angle of internal friction, and that's a very important one. The angle of internal friction, well, mechanical engineers are used to think of friction coefficients. Civil engineers are usually used to think in terms of an angle of friction. Well, what is the difference? There is no difference. If you take the tangent of the angle of internal friction, you have the friction coefficient. Yeah, so basically it's the same, it's just another way of putting it. This angle of internal friction you will find in all equations, whether we are talking about clay, sand, rock, you have to deal with the angle of internal friction. Now, a very important thing, and I always notice at exams that people mix it up, friction depends on normal stress or normal force. So the friction force is the normal force times the friction coefficient, right? If I don't have any normal force, I don't have any friction force. Later we will also talk about cohesion and adhesion, which basically is shear strength. Well, adhesion is the sticky effect of a material, and adhesion does not need normal force. So if I take adhesive tape and I put it on the table and I start pulling, I'm not pushing on the tape. The tape has adhesive strength itself. Yeah, so cohesion and adhesion are shear strength and they do not require a normal force. Friction you only have if you also have normal force or normal stress. Here we talk about the angle of internal friction, and for normal sands, I would say the angle of internal friction is somewhere between 30 degrees and 45 degrees. Those are not absolute limits, but somebody can always find a sand with 25 degrees or 50 degrees, but I would say 95% of the sands is between 30 and 45 degrees, something like that. Here you see a small table. Again, they use the SPT value. In many soil mechanics books you will find that, and the reason is that SPT is so easy to determine. It's very cheap and you can do it anywhere in the world. You don't need an expensive laboratory for that. So you can see a classification of sand. Very loose sand has a very low SPT value and a angle of internal friction of about 30 degrees. Here they say 29, but it's 29-30 is about the same. Then loose 29-30, medium 30 to 36, dense 36 to 41, and very dense sand bigger than 41. Now this angle of internal friction does not only depend on the density of the sand, so how compact it is, it also depends strongly on the angularity of the particles. So if I have very round particles, it will be lower. If I have very angular particles, it will be higher. So if you do a dredging project up in the mountains, probably you will have a much higher angle of internal friction. If you do it in the sea near an estuary, probably the sand is already quite rounded and the friction angles will be a little bit smaller. Here you also see, in fact, what you have here. Here the SPT value and here the angle of internal friction, and there is some correlation equation for that. So if I know my SPT value, I can determine the angle of internal friction, but the red lines give the scatter of those measurements. So there is a scatter of plus minus 3 degrees, which is quite a lot. This is a picture I found in a book of petroleum engineering here about mining, and it gives the relation between the friction force and the normal force for many types of rock. And if you put some lines through it, in fact, this angle gives you the angle of internal friction, and that's the angle between friction and normal force. But if you take the lowest points, I think you would get at somewhere like 20 degrees or 25 degrees. But it's just an example of measurements they did. In rock, of course, it's more difficult to determine the angle of friction than in sand. If you just take two pieces of sandpaper, you stick one to the table and the other one at the top, and you put a certain weight on it, and then you start pulling, and you take the normal force and the pulling force, you already have your angle of friction of that sandpaper. And that's how you can do it. And if you want to know the external friction angle, which is the friction between sand and some other material like steel, well, just put the sandpaper on a piece of steel and do the same experiment, and you measure the friction angle between sand and steel. external friction angle, so that's the angle between sand, well, or rock or whatever, and in our case it's always the cutter head, so that's steel. In general, what people do, you see some correlations here. What I always do, I take 2/3 of the angle of internal friction. It doesn't have to be that way. It could be a little bit different. But first of all, the angle of external friction that you can measure can never be bigger than the internal friction angle. Yeah? Theoretically, it could. But suppose I have a blade and sand is moving over the blade, and the friction between the sand and the blade is bigger than the angle of internal friction. What will happen is the particles will stick to the blade, and one layer away from the blade, the particles will start shearing over each other with the angle of internal friction. So in such a case, I will measure the angle of internal friction, although I could make a surface of sand particles. I glue all the sand particles to that surface, and that way I create a higher friction angle. But still, what I measure will be the internal friction angle, because the sand will start shearing internally. Yeah, so that's why I say the maximum external friction angle is the internal friction angle. You will never measure more, although theoretically it could. But in general, I take 0.67 or 2/3, and that works very fine, but it's just a rule of the thumb. And if you want to know exactly, you have to do measurements. But I noticed we did a lot of cutting tests in our laboratory, and what I noticed with giving some sand samples to the soil mechanics laboratory, and then you get values for this external friction angle, they do not match what we found in the laboratory, because you, during a cutting test, you have completely different stress conditions as in a standard test in the laboratory. So I prefer to get my data from the real experiments. Clay, cohesion, adhesion. Later we will talk more in detail about it, but cohesion is the internal shear strength of a material. So in clay we often talk about cohesion, but we also talk about shear strength. In fact, for steel you could also talk about cohesion, but nobody does. Everybody will call it shear strength. Yeah, but cohesion is equivalent to shear strength for me in the way we talk, and adhesion is the external shear strength. So in both cases you talk about shear strength, and they are not depending on any normal stress or normal force. Here you get a table with some values. Well, we talk about very soft clay. Well, here they talk about the UCS. I will explain later. It's the unconfined compressive strength, which normally is 2 times the cohesion. Smaller than 24, that would be a clay that you used when you were little. In Dutch we say boetseerklei. So very soft clay. It's also very sticky, and often the adhesion of such a clay has about the same value as the cohesion. So the external sticky effect is about the same as the internal sticky effect. And of course that depends on the other material. Yeah, but and then the harder you get, and here you have almost 400 kPa UCS value, the harder it gets, the smaller the adhesion. So if you take a very hard clay, it is possible that it hardly has any adhesion anymore. And with certain types of rock, in fact, if you keep compacting the clay, it could become a sort of sedimentary rock. And yeah, if you put your hand on the outside of such a rock, you will not notice any sticky effect. So the adhesion is almost zero, or it is zero. Yeah, so with clay, you cannot really say adhesion is like 50% of the cohesion. No, for very small cohesions, it's almost equal. For very high cohesions, it's almost zero. In offshore, they have to deal a lot with clays, for example, with suction anchors and other types of anchors. And if you look at the regulations of the classification bureaus like API and DNV and so on, they have a rule that you take the adhesion 50% of the cohesion. Well, this completely depends on, is it soft clay or hard clay? You cannot say it's 50%. But what is the task of those classification bureaus? So you have in Europe we use Veritas a lot, DNV, Lloyd's, API is from the American Petroleum Institute. What is their task? They work for an insurance company, right? So their task is to set rules that take care it will not be damaged. It will take care that if you build a ship or a platform, it will stay intact for a long time, at least like 30 years. Because if it doesn't, they have to pay. Yeah, so all their rules contain safety factors. Don't try to explain their rules with scientific equations, because you will get confused. Often it doesn't work. In fact, for the holding capacity of anchors, I found that you have certain graphs from API, and you also have certain graphs from a company in Holland named Vrijhof Ankers, who produce anchors. The line of API is very conservative, so the holding capacity of anchors is relatively low. But if you take the book of the anchor company, it's much higher for exactly the same anchor. So I once gave students an assignment. I want to see, what do you find based on science? And they found a line in the middle. And then you can say, yeah, of course. API wants to be conservative, otherwise they have to pay if it goes wrong. And Vrijhof Ankers wants to sell anchors. So they are more positive. That's the way it works. But if you look in those books or on internet, be careful with what you find there, because usually it doesn't have enough scientific base. It contains safety factors. And when you make a design in your master thesis, we want to see the scientific basis. And then if you say, well, this is what I calculated and I like to put a safety factor of 1.5 or 2 on it, perfect. But then it's clear what is the safety factor. Yeah, so we always want to see everything based on science. Okay, this was some clay. Quickly we will do some of the testing equipment. This is a unconfined compressive stress. Well, in fact, you just take a cylinder of material, you start compressing it until it fails, and you measure the relation between stress and strain. So here you have the stress, here the strain. You will probably find a maximum, which we call the compressive strength, and usually after it collapses, the stress will also collapse because the material already failed. And the shape of such a diagram tells you something about the material. So that's the UCS value. And like I already said, the cohesion, the shear strength, is usually 50% of the UCS value. But I will explain that more in detail when we do the Mohr circle. Unconfined tensile strength. Yeah, you want to have a sample like this. You do a tensile, you start pulling on it, and when it fails, that's the tensile strength. What we use more for rock is the so-called Brazilian split test, the Brazilian tensile test. You will find the abbreviation BTS in many books, which comes from this test. What they do, they take a cylinder of rock, you put it horizontal, start pushing on it, and if you push hard enough, it will split in two at once. Yeah, so you get a split over this line, and then you have a simple equation of calculating the tensile strength of the material. So this is an important one because we use it often in dredging, and especially when you do deep sea mining. Yeah, people will say, what is the BTS value? Brittle versus ductile. Brittle, you can have brittle in two ways. Well, let's first talk about ductile. Ductile means that you have a nice continuous failure process with plastic deformations, but no cracks. Yeah, it's a nice continuous failure mechanism. It's like when you are cutting steel in a turning machine, you get a continuous chip, hardly any fractures. So that's ductile. Steel is a ductile material. But if you cut rock, yeah, everybody noticed, if I put a pick point or whatever in Beitel or in the rock and I start pushing, at a certain point the whole chip will be blown out, and that's what we call brittle. Now, basically you have two types of brittle. You have tensile failure, which can cause brittle failure, and you have shear failure. So if suddenly it shears like this, that could also be brittle. So brittle is not just a tensile fracture, it could be a shear fracture. And in rock cutting, very often both mechanisms occur at the same time during the process of rock cutting. Well, if you are busy with ductile cutting and you do a test, you will see the stress increases, and at a certain point it's almost constant. It can still increase a little bit, and that's when you have ductile behavior. If you have the brittle behavior, like we saw in the UCS test, you get a maximum stress, and after that it collapses because the material fails. Yeah, maybe it could even go back to zero, depends on the test. Some other tests, the SPT, I already mentioned it. SPT, you take a cylinder with a certain diameter and a certain cone angle. That's important, that the cone angle is standard. It's 60 degrees usually. You hit with a certain weight. In fact, the way they start, that you drop the weight over a fixed distance and you get a certain impulse on the cylinder. And then you count the number of hits. They call it the number of blows per feet. So it's an American invention. And the number of blows per feet, that's the SPT value. So you can imagine if the ground is harder, tougher, I need more blows per feet and I have a higher SPT value. So this gives an example of that. Then we also have the CPT, the cone penetration test. It's also a cylinder with a certain diameter, also a cone of 60 degrees. But in this case you need much more equipment. You push it into the ground with a fixed velocity. So it's not with blows, it's with a constant velocity. And if you look at those devices, they put many different transducers in, so you can measure the resistance, but you could also measure the porosity of the ground by having pressure transducers or whatever. You can measure the friction and the adhesion on the cylinder by having special segments for that. In fact, you could measure whatever you want to measure, so those are much more complicated devices. And you need this truck with enough weight, otherwise you don't have enough force to push it into the ground. So this is already a much more expensive way of determining something from the soil, but it's more fundamental. It is better, but it's also more expensive. Those are some of the cones they have, and usually you can see behind the cone there is a section where they measure the friction. Triaxial test, very important. I will tell more about it when we do the Mohr circle. But here you have a piece of material. It could be sand, it could be clay, just a piece of material. In this chamber you could put a certain pressure, confined pressure. Yeah, you could do that. You could say, okay, I want a hydrostatic pressure of 300 bars like in deep sea mining, and then I will do my test. Yeah, you could do that. Then you start pushing from the top. And then when the material fails, you get a so-called Mohr circle out of that, but usually I like Mohr circles at different confined pressures to get the angle of internal friction and so on and so on. We will look at that when we do the Mohr circle. Yeah, so this is a device, this is the real device. They use it a lot in soil mechanics. This is a simple test to measure shear. So here you have your soil. You push with a certain stress, you put a normal stress on it, and you can measure your friction, or you could measure your adhesion. Yeah, that's also a way, and you can make it as fancy as you want. And then we have the vein shear test. They often use this in, for example, silt or weak clay, but if the clay is too hard, probably it won't work. Here you have a vein. You start rotating it, you measure the resistance, and that's a measure for your shear strength. Yeah, or yeah, in this case it's the shear strength. I think that's it for today. And then next week we will continue with Mohr circle, active, passive, and with sand cutting.